Dear friends, welcome to this edition of VBS Anatoma, a series of e-learning lecture videos on gross anatomy. We are covering the head and neck region, and today's class specifically is on the thyroid gland gross features, part 1. Before we start, let's look at the following points. This is the MCA competency number, and these are some of the items we would be covering in this section, of which part 1, only a few of these we will cover. The rest in other part 2, part 3, we will continue. Now, the color code for labels is integrated into the video. The must know labels across the slides is uniformly labeled in a black script against a light gray background, and that material, that label, is an indicator of a must know structure and its details. In contrast, the reverse is true, where the script is in white and the background is black. That is nice to know. This cuts across all the slides and it's uniformly used in this video. In the initial part, we will cover the location, orientation, and surface marking. There is also an MCQ, a set of MCQs, image-based MCQs at the end of the video. And after the question MCQs, there is a last slide with the answer keys. Now you see, yeah, look at this photograph of the front of the neck. Will draw your attention to the following important landmarks. Now that's the rough position of the thyroid gland. For that, the laryngeal prominence or the thyroid angle, or what you can say is the Adam's apple if it was the corresponding neck in the males. Sternocleidomastoid, it's a huge bulky muscle. It forms a very prominent elevation obliquely across the neck from the sternoclavicular joint right up towards the mastoid process. Then there will be a small dip or a small pit or a shallow pit immediately above the manubrium that refers to the location of the brachia. With this important landmarks, let's try to zoom in on the thyroid gland. Now you see, when you palpate from below upwards, the isthmus is the part of the gland that is seen in the midline. The point is to get this surface marked, you need to identify the cricoid cartilage. Usually when you palpate above the suprasternal notch, it is easy to get this cricoid cartilage roughly about 5 centimeters above. Once the cricoid is known, there are two tracheal rings below which the isthmus is located. So you can draw two lines roughly an inch across or a little less than that, one below the other, a stamp shaped area as you see now. That will roughly correspond to the isthmus. Using this isthmus, the two lateral edges are the end points of the upper and the lower border, you draw a pyramidal structure in such a way that the base of the pyramid is lower down and the apex is high up. They raise the apex up to a point roughly at the level of the middle of the thyroid cartilage and make sure that the two apices are slightly apart compared to that of the base. This will give you a rough idea of the surface marking and by virtue of it, its location and orientation. So in the name surface marking, we have therefore already identified that this gland has an isthmus and a set of lobes, right lobe and a left lobe, and as already mentioned, the isthmus. Above the isthmus, there is a small prolongation, as in this case. That small prolongation upwards is the pyramidal lobe, not labeled here, but further beyond it, the lobe, pyramidal lobe, gives way to a fibrous structure. Occasionally, there may be some glandular tissue. This fibrous structure goes up towards the hyoid bone. That's called the levator glandulae thyroidea. Now, in the actual dissection, you can see right above the isthmus, upper border, is located the cricoid cartilage. I kept the label a little low. Otherwise, you know, if I put the label, the cricoid cartilage will not be visible. But here it is very clearly seen because right along its upper border, the cricothyroid muscle is visible. Therefore, I have pointed it out. Next, as already mentioned in the surface marking, the tracheal rings can be seen in the region immediately below the isthmus of the thyroid. Here, we have identified two other important cartilaginous landmarks, the thyroid cartilage and as the two laminae of the thyroid cartilage fuse in the midline, the laryngeal prominence. Now, this laryngeal prominence or the thyroid angle is in the males, it, as told earlier, is called the Adam's apple. It is more prominent because they fuse at a right angle, whereas in the females, the less prominence because it is the angle is little more in the females. Nevertheless, please note that these two items are important landmarks for our discussion. That concludes the important surface landmarks. But remember, in the immediate vicinity of the gland, there are a number of structures, particularly in front, before you actually reach the gland. There are a number of strap muscles, the sternohyoid, sternothyroid, thyrohyoid, and the cricothyroid muscle. Remember, cricothyroid has been shown here because it's clearly visible, but it is not one of the list of the strap muscles. It is one of the intrinsic muscles of the larynx. Next, that huge bulky muscle is the sternocleidomastoid. I have labeled it on one side. That's the hyoid bone. Now, for clinical requirements, let's try to have a brief run through of some of the ectopic positions in which the thyroid can be seen. This is closely correlated with embryology, where we will cover it in further detail, but suffice at this stage to remember that it can be anywhere along the course of the descent of the thyroid gland, right from the foramen cecum to the lower part of the neck, or sometimes even beyond. Now, the common, the uncommon locations are ectopic locations of the thyroid. It could be present either lingual or a sublingual in position, or a suprahyoid or an infrahyoid position, or retrosternal or mediastinal in position, or it may be remote, far, far away from any of these places, like in the case of pancreas, gallbladder, ovary, small intestine, in the mesentery of the small intestine, or either the gland may be present, or It may be a remnant of the embryonic development. It may be in the form of a cyst, a duct, a fistula, or it could be a tumor. Next, surfaces and borders. Now, the anterior surface of the isthmus is clearly shown here. Now, the isthmus and the lobes are closely plastered to the trachea and the adjacent cartilages. That is how it is anchored to this the deep structures. In a later set of slides, we will discuss a few points about these ligaments, in particular about the ligament of Berry, things like that. But right now, it is clearly visible, the anterior surface of the isthmus. I have put a white and red dotted area to show the outline of the gland. Now you see, that is the upper border of the isthmus, lower border of the isthmus. Now the lobes, anterior surface, you can also call it anterolateral. Some books do give it as anterolateral surface. The anterior border of a lobe, right lobe. On the other side, on the left side, I have shown the lower pole. Now you see, the upper pole is visible on both sides, but I have labeled it on the left side. Just like I showed you the anterior border, there is also a posterior border for the lobe, which has been marked here. Now this is a side view. You are looking at the thyroid from the left side. Left lateral view, and two things are particularly striking. The posterolateral surface, the area clearly visible as an island, and behind it the posterior border. Next, remember, to show the medial surface, we have cut out the ligamentous attachment of the isthmus and the adjacent lobe. And we have flipped the lobe to show the medial surface. So now in this case, the medial surface is actually pointing upwards. That's the medial surface. Generally, it is not visible in the anatomical position. Next, this for the same reason of having cut the isthmus and displaced the lobe, the right lobe has been flipped to show the posterior border. So don't get misguided. This is actually the posterior border. The gland has been flipped to show the posterior border. And along the posterior border, you can see two nodules. There is a black, slightly blackish area surrounded by an yellow or an ivory yellow circle. Though the one is bigger and the other one is tiny. They are the parathyroid glands, very important posterior relations along the posterior border of the thyroid lobe. That overall covers the first few points for the thyroid. We will continue the relations of the thyroid in the next video. In the meanwhile, it's time to run through the image based MCQs. MCQ number one, identify the pointed structure. There are four answers. Choose the right answer. Be ready. The key will be given to you at the end of this video. MCQ number two, the butterfly shaped area refers to the ectopic location of the thyroid gland. Which location is this? By virtue of what you learned in the discussion. Third, here is a lobe of the thyroid, right side thyroid lobe, the right lobe of the thyroid is shown. One particular surface has been pointed out. What is it? I have already given you the key. Next, which border of the gland is this? Think, keep an eye on the answer. Last one, identify the pointed surface. Remember, after all, this discussion was only about borders and surfaces. So yet another surface I have pointed out. What is it? If you are fairly confident of answering. I'm sure most of you would have got 5 out of 5. Let's have a check. Now that's the answer key. I will leave it sufficiently long so that you can cross-check it. Otherwise, pause the video on this slide. Recheck your answers. Now that was a short run through or a walk through the initial aspects of the gross anatomy of the thyroid gland. Thank you, and let's continue in part 2 the further details like the relations, other applied aspects, etc. Anatoma Jyotirgamaya.